So let us start the course on quantum field theory. So we have already taken a course on quantum mechanics and classical electrodynamics, and probably you have also taken a course on special theory of relativity in your undergraduate classes. So quantum field theory is basically a framework to understand interactions between particles, and it finds applications in almost all branches of physics. For example, in condensed matter physics, in astrophysics, in understanding various aspects, formal aspects of quantum field theory, in various branches of theoretical physics also. So quantum field theory finds applications almost everywhere, and it is a framework to understand, as I have mentioned, that in order to understand interactions between particles, it is a framework for that. And not only that, it may seem that it is a tool to understand various branches of physics, but it is not true that it is only a tool. It is something more than that. So why do I say that quantum field theory is just not a tool, but it is something more than that? It is something more than that because it is something very fundamental, and one should realize that just as there are classical fields around us, for example, electromagnetic fields we have already encountered, these are classical fields, or for that matter the gravitational field, this is also a classical field theory. There are quantum fields around us, and one can really observe effects due to these quantum fields which are there around us. So quantum fields are there, they are very fundamental to our very existence. They are around us and they give rise to effects which can be observed in principle, which has been observed, and which can devise various experiments to observe the effects of quantum field theory, of these quantum fields which exist around us. So this is the motivation of studying quantum field theory. Not only that, as I mentioned, that it finds applications in condensed matter physics, but in what sense? It is a general framework to understand. Quantum field theory is a general framework to understand many body physics. So if you want to understand many body physics in a proper way, you must take recourse to the tools that are available from quantum field theory. Why? Let me give you a simple example. Consider the hydrogen atom. And you know that this hydrogen atom, this is the simplest one electron system. You know that this hydrogen atom has energy levels, right? This has quantized energy levels. And if you excite the electron of the hydrogen atom to one of the excited energy levels, say with principal quantum number n is equal to 2 or n is equal to 3, then what will happen? This electron that gets excited, that has been excited to this higher excited state, higher energy state, will want to come back to the ground state. So it will want to decay, right? A decay process. It will always want to come to the ground state. And in the process, what happens is that the observable effect is that you get certain lines which correspond to the electromagnetic radiation that has been emitted due to the transition of the electron from a higher excited state to a lower excited, to the ground state. So some electromagnetic radiation has come out when the electron makes a transition, and these electromagnetic radiation we observe as spectral lines, right? Now, the point is that if you, from a theoretical perspective, if you look at the hydrogen atom, what we do in the hydrogen atom is we write down the Hamiltonian of the hydrogen atom, and this is the Hamiltonian of a hydrogen atom with only one electron, right? You can in principle write down the Hamiltonian of the full hydrogen atom with one electron and one proton, and then you can go to the center of mass coordinates and relative coordinates and make the approximation that the proton is much heavier than the electron, and then you forget about the dynamics of the proton, only concentrate on the electron, and then you write down the Hamiltonian, and then you go to solve this Hamiltonian using the Schrödinger equation, and you get the various energy levels and also the energy eigenstates corresponding to these energy levels. So this is the Hamiltonian of the hydrogen atom, consists of a single electron. But in the process, what we find is that you get these energy levels. These energy levels actually gives rise to the spectral lines, because when the electron makes a transition from the excited state to the ground state, it will emit photons. So let me just draw a picture. So suppose this is n is equal to 2, this is n is equal to 1, and the electron makes a transition from here to here, and in the process it emits a photon. Now, nowhere in your formulation, in your Schrödinger equation, does the photon arise. The Schrödinger equation or the Hamiltonian consists of only this electron. But what you observe in the laboratory, and also what you have in your theoretical, in the spectrum that you have derived for this hydrogen atom, you already see that you also have photons in your theory, right? It is not only that the hydrogen atom consists of only one electron. When the electron makes transition, there are photons coming out. These are the electromagnetic radiation that is coming out from this system. But nowhere in your formulation are these photons taken into account. The photons are not there in the Schrödinger equation. So to start with, you had one electron, but after you do the calculation, you see that you have photons in your picture. Where have the photons come from? The Schrödinger equation, the single particle Schrödinger equation, the quantum mechanical framework cannot answer this question. The only way you can answer this question from where the photons have come from is if you go to many body physics. And many body physics means you have to take recourse to the tools that are available from quantum field theory. Only quantum field, if you apply quantum field theory, then you can explain the origin of these photons in a proper theoretical way, in a satisfying way. It's a theory that will encompass, but that will cover all the particles that are present in this problem. Quantum field theory is the only approach to do this. This is another motivation that I have given you. If you think about some other motivation, for example, if you remember old quantum theory, the light quantum hypothesis of Einstein. So that says that photons, electromagnetic radiation, are basically, it is quantized in packets of energy or in energy packets, and these energy packets are called photons. So you get the particle picture. But electromagnetic theory, you know, is at least at the classical level, light is basically a wave. So you have the classical description of electromagnetism. But here we find from the light quantum hypothesis proposed by Albert Einstein that electromagnetic radiation can also have, apart from its wave nature, it can also have a particle nature. So it is quantized in energy packets, and these packets are called photons. But this is ad hoc, this is just a hypothesis, that light is quantized in packets of energy. So if you have a classical description of electromagnetism, then then there must be a quantum description of electromagnetism, which will actually give rise in a rigorous way, in a fundamental way, to this particle picture of light. The fact that light has a particle character can only come out if you quantize electrodynamics. And the way or the procedure in which you quantize electromagnetic theory, it actually gives rise to a quantum field theory, which is a theory of many photons. It takes into account in its framework, you can have infinite number of photons. The only way you can get to a particle picture of light from a wave picture of light is to quantize electrodynamics. And when you quantize electrodynamics, the theory that you get is nothing but a quantum field theory. So now you can understand why quantum field theory is very important. So I have now given you many, many motivations. Another thing is that I mentioned earlier is that you must have learned electrodynamics. You have already learned in your undergraduate as well as in your postgraduate classes. You have also learned, taken a course on special theory of relativity. Now, the field theories, the quantum field theories that we shall discuss in this course will be mostly quantum, relativistic quantum field theories. What are relativistic quantum field theories? Relativistic quantum field theories is basically a unification of quantum mechanics with special theory of relativity. So, if you remember that the wave mechanics formulation given by Schrödinger, this is basically a non-relativistic formulation of quantum mechanics. It is non-relativistic in nature. And then came Dirac, and Dirac gave the relativistic formulation of quantum mechanics, the correct description of relativistic description of quantum mechanics. But this Dirac equation that you have learned in the last semester also has certain problems. You have this Fermi C, the negative energy C, the C of electrons with negative energy, which is called the Dirac C of electrons. So this is a problem in the theory, because you started, once again, as I mentioned, for the hydrogen atom, you started with the theory of one electron, but now you have, in order to come out of certain inconsistencies that may arise, you are proposing that it is also filled by a negative C of electrons, so that the electron from a positive energy state cannot tunnel to the negative energy state and go down further and further to minus infinity, energy with minus infinity. So in order to save the electron from its very existence, Dirac had to propose that the negative energy states are filled with electrons, which all have negative energy, and this is the Dirac C of electrons. So you started with one electron, but in order to save your day, you have to propose that there are many, many electrons in your theory with negative energies. How can that be? Because to start with, the equation cannot accommodate a theory of many electrons. And that is why you have to give a new theory which can accommodate, or which is a theory of many particles. And that is nothing but quantum field theory. The quantum field theory that we shall discuss here are relativistic quantum field theories, and therefore special theory of relativity is very important. Relativistic quantum field theories are nothing but quantum field theories on a flat Minkowski background. So the underlying space-time background that you have in relativistic quantum field theory is a special relativistic background. It is a flat space-time. And all of us know, you must have studied that are you familiar with this notation? Have you encountered this notation earlier? Some of the students have done some
projects. Sir. Okay. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Very good. So I'm sure that since you have done projects with the faculty members in the theory group, you must be familiar with this four vector notation. You must have seen this in electrodynamics also. So this tells you that the line element which is invariant under Lorentz transformations is given by this, where eta mu nu is a flat Minkowski spacetime metric. And the signature that we shall use in this course will be mostly negative. So we shall say that this is our signature. The signature is plus 1, minus 1, minus 1, minus 1, only the diagonal components. Therefore, these are all constants. Therefore, it is flat Minkowski metric. And this is mostly negative because you have the negative signs are larger in number than the positive sign. Therefore, it is mostly negative signature. And the quantum field theories that we shall discuss or that we shall study in this course have been formulated with this as the background space-time. So these quantum field theories, basically these theories are Lorentz invariant theories. And the action that you write is Lorentz invariant. Lagrangian density that you write is Lorentz invariant. So therefore these theories are called relativistic quantum field theories, and we shall study these theories. In many body physics that finds applications, the many body formalism, it is the central tool in condensed matter physics, right? There what people do is study quantum field theories, non-relativistic quantum field theories. So those are theories for which the background space-time is not this. Those are theories which are invariant under Galilean transformations, non-relativistic transformations. Those are also quantum field theories, but those are not relativistic quantum field theories. Those are non-relativistic quantum field theories. And if we have time in this course, then we shall also discuss such theories. But let me start today with relativistic quantum field theory. I'm sure that you are familiar with some relativistic quantum field theories from your last course. You must have seen the real scalar field, the complex scalar field. Have you seen these two fields?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So it's good that you have seen, but we shall again revise what a real scalar field is, what a complex scalar field is. We shall go through it because we have a lot of time. It is just January and we can go till the end of April, I think. So we have a lot of time, so we can discuss a lot of things in this course. So it will be good if we again revise what a real scalar field is, what a complex scalar field is. Have you learned what a Dirac field is?
Not in details, sir.
Not in details. Have you learned what a Maxwell field is? No, have sir. You quantized a gauge field?
Probably not.
No, sir.
Okay, very good. So, but what we shall do today is start with the quantization of a real scalar field. Let us go through it once again. I hope that I have given you a clear motivation of why a person should study quantum field theory in the first place. So in any subject that you learn, you should always ask the question that why am I studying this particular subject? Why is it that I am spending such a lot of time in learning this subject? And I think I have given you quite a few number of examples where you will find that quantum field theory is really important or really necessary for our existence. I have not given you one more example. If I get some time, or if I get at the end of the class today itself, I may give you that final thing that will actually tell you, it is like a thought experiment that will actually tell you that okay, really that it is really true that quantum fields really exist around us. So you will understand why one must study quantum field theories. Okay. So let us start with a real scalar field, and let us write down the action for a real scalar field. I am sure that you are familiar with this. So this is the action for the real scalar field. This phi is the real scalar field. Why at the consider this phi as a classical function? So it is a real scalar because the complex conjugate of phi is basically equal to the field itself. Therefore, it is a real, this function is a real function. We are not talking about quantum field theory now. This is at the classical level. And what is this d4x? This d4x is basically d cubed x times dt. So this is the spatial volume and this is the time part. We know that this d4x is invariant under, this is the four volume, and it is invariant under Lorentz transformations. This thing, this full thing that we have written down, this is called the Lagrangian density. Is the Lagrangian density, which I have denoted by a script L, not L, script L. And this Lagrangian density is also invariant under Lorentz transformations. Now, this thing you can write it down as dt d cubed x L. So you see that there are two integrals. This integral is over the volume V and this integral is over the time. Can you see the board? Is it visible?
Yes, sir.
Good. Why is this called Lagrangian density? Because you see this quantity multiplied by the volume. Integrate, if you integrate over the volume, this gives you the total Lagrangian, capital L. And Lagrangian into dt integral is nothing but the action, and therefore this script L is the Lagrangian density. Okay. This is a real function because phi star x is phi x. And why is this a real scalar? This is a scalar field. It's a scalar field because if you make a transformation like x going to x prime is equal to some function of x, maybe it is a Lorentz transformation, or maybe it is some transformation, x going to x prime, which is some function of x, under that transformation phi x goes to phi prime x prime is equal to phi of x. So if this function phi transforms in this way, phi, it goes to phi prime x prime and it is equal to phi of x, then it is said to be a scalar function, it's a scalar field. And it is a real scalar field because phi star x is equal to phi of x. It is real because of this condition, it is scalar because of this condition. And therefore this theory is that of a real scalar field. Why did I start from this action or this Lagrangian density? Because if you apply the principle of least action, that is, if you extremize this action S, that will lead us to this. Klein-Gordon equation. So if you extremize this action, this will lead us to this Klein-Gordon equation. And we have seen in relativistic quantum mechanics course that that if you interpret this as a wave function, then there is a problem. The Klein-Gordon equation, you cannot interpret it as a wave function. This is not, this phi is not a relativistic wave function. Why? Because you will find that it does not admit a proper probability interpretation. If you write down the probability density from this, which is constructed out of this field phi, then you will find that the probability density is not positive definite, and therefore this phi cannot be interpreted as a relativistic wave function. So there is a problem. So that is why the interpretation of this equation as a relativistic quantum mechanical equation or relativistic wave function equation for this relativistic wave function, quantum mechanical equation for this relativistic wave function does not go through because it does not admit a proper probability density interpretation. But it can be, there is no problem if you interpret this, instead of saying that this is a wave function, relativistic wave function, if you say that it is not a relativistic wave function, it is a field. If you interpret this as a field, then there is no problem. If you, because once you interpret this as a field, then there is no question of any probability density or anything like that. It is not quantum mechanical wave function. So there is, you should not confuse or you should not think about any probability density interpretation. So interpreting this equation as a classical field equation is completely all right. It's completely perfect. And therefore, this is not only called a real scalar field theory. This is also called a Klein-Gordon field theory. Klein-Gordon scalar field theory, real scalar field theory. Okay. So now, let me also tell you that in this course, we shall use the natural limits. That is, h bar is equal to 1 and speed of light c is equal to 1. So these are the natural limits, although they, as we take it, it looks as highly unnatural, but we say that it is natural limit, right? But this h bar, if you set h bar 2 equal to 1 and c equal to 1, this is highly an unnatural process, but still we call it as natural unit. So we shall take this, we shall use natural units, and in this unit you will see that the dimension of the action is s. So dimension, we denote it by square brackets. The action is dimensionless. in this natural units, the action is dimensionless. Because you remember that you have learned the path integral formulation in the previous semester. If you remember correctly, then you will always remember this famous factor, e to the power of I by h bar action s. Do you remember this?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Very good. So what should be the dimension of action? The action should have the dimension of h bar. Action has to have the dimension of angular momentum. H bar has the dimension of angular momentum. Therefore, action has to have the dimension of angular momentum. Because e to the power of i by h bar s, this exponent must be dimensionless. Therefore, s has to have the dimension of h bar. But in the natural units, we have set h bar to be equal to 1, and therefore the action is dimensionless in natural units. In standard units, the action has the dimension of angular momentum. So now if this is dimensionless, then let us look at the right hand side of this equation. What is the dimension of d4x? d4x dimension is l to the power of 4, length to the power of 4. One more thing I should mention, this is the action of a real scalar free field theory. This free term is very important because this has no interactions. You can consider this as an interaction term, like harmonic oscillator term, m square phi square. But with this interaction, you can solve the model exactly. The model can be solved exactly.
Sir?
Huh.
Why don't D Fourier has the dimension of L cubed D? I mean, C is taken to 1.
Okay. D4x is what? D cubed x into dt.
Yes.
D cubed x dimension is L cubed.
Yes.
And in the natural limit C is equal to 1, time has the same dimension as length. Therefore, the t is same as length, and that is equal to 1 by m. Mass is inverse of length. Why? E is equal to mc square.
Okay.
Right?
Yes.
Let us start from here. Energy is equal to h nu, and energy is also equal to mc square. Okay? H does not have a dimension because h bar does not have a dimension. In natural units, h bar is nothing but h by 2 pi. Therefore, energy has this, the dimension of energy is the same as the dimension of frequency. And what is the dimension of frequency? 1 by time. And what is the dimension of time? It is same as length. From here, in C is equal to 1 unit, energy has the same dimension as mass. So this is mass dimension, capital M, mass. Therefore, from here we find that mass is inverse of time, and therefore inverse of length. And therefore, you have this. Another thing is that in this action, we call this as the mass term. This is called the mass term. Is it okay?
Yes, sir.
Now, why do we call this mass term? So let us come back to this discussion one second, the discussion of dimensions. Look at the right hand side. What is the dimension of d4x? L to the power of 4. What is the dimension of del mu? Del mu is del mu
1 by L.
Is nothing but this. So the dimension of derivative is nothing but 1 by L. Very good. How many 1 by L's are there? How many derivatives are there? 1 and 2. Therefore, this gives a factor of 1 by L square. Therefore, how many fields are there? 2 fields. So phi square, the dimension of the field phi square times length square, because length 4 and 1 by length square, that must be equal to 1, because the left hand side is dimensionless. And therefore, the dimension of field phi is nothing but 1 by length, which is nothing but mass dimension. So the field phi has the dimension of mass. Let us now come back, look at the last term. This is d4x, so this is L to the power of 4. There are two phi's, therefore this is 1 by length square, because phi has dimension of inverse of length. So this is 1 by L square, and then we have the m dimension square, and that must be equal to 1. Therefore, L square and this cancels, and therefore the dimension of the term m, this m has dimension of 1 by length, which is nothing but mass. So we have proved that this m has the dimension of mass, and therefore we call this as the mass term. Okay? So I hope this dimension thing is clear to you. You should always keep this thing in your mind. You should always worry about the dimensions of various quantities. This is something very important when you are dealing with physical quantities. You should always check the dimensions of those quantities. Very good. And as I mentioned, that we shall work with the signature, mostly negative signature. This is our signature throughout this course. Let us now come back, look at the Klein-Gödel equation. So let me just introduce this notation. X mu is x0, xi, I is 1, 2, 3, because we are looking at all these field theories that we shall discuss will be in 3 plus 1 dimensions. So there are 3 spatial directions and 1 time direction. And the signature is mostly negative. So the spatial directions have minus, minus, minus sign. The time direction has plus sign, plus signature. So x mu is this. And now let us look at the Klein-Gödel equation. Solutions of this Klein-Gödel equation are this and this. These are the solutions of this Klein-Gödel equation. And if you just, or if you just take this as the answers, so this is the 4 momenta. This is basically k0, ki. So if this is the 4 momentum k, so what is e to the power of, what is k dot x? K dot x is basically k mu x mu, or you can also write this as k mu x mu in this way, whatever way you want to write. So if you just substitute any of this in this equation, then immediately what you will find is box plus m square e to the power of I is equal to 0. Box acting on this will give us, so this would imply minus k square m square plus m square phi, or e to the power of I k dot x is equal to 0. Okay. This cannot be equal to 0. E to the power of I k dot x, it cannot be equal to 0. And therefore, this must be equal to 0. And this gives you the must shell condition that k square must be equal to m square. This is the must shell condition that one gets from the equation of motion. What is k square? K square is k0, k0, plus ki, ki. But since our signature is this, mostly negative, therefore k0 contravariant, k0 covariant is nothing but k0 square. I can just take the lower index to the upper position, there will be no change in sign. But what about this? If I do the same thing for this, this will give me a negative sign. This is nothing but ki square. But what is ki contravariant square? This is nothing but k vector square. And therefore, we get k0 to be equal to plus minus k vector square plus m square square root. So you see, you get back the famous relation in special theory of relativity that the energy is equal to plus minus square root of k vector square plus m square. So to start with, the k0 component and the ki components were independent, but once you pluck the solution, the answers in the Klein-Gordon equation, k0 now becomes dependent on the three vector k vector. So they are no longer independent variables, and this k0, I call this as omega k vector. I label it with omega k vector, and therefore I can write k mu as omega k vector k vector. So now the zeroth component and the three components, the spatial components, are no longer independent. They are dependent by this mass shell condition. And this mass shell condition arises from the Klein-Gordon equation. Okay. So you see that these are the solutions of the Klein-Gordon equation with the constraint that the four momentum k mu is given by this, where omega k is given by this relation. Okay. The next step is to introduce periodic boundary conditions. Let us introduce periodic boundary conditions. This is the next step. And what we shall do is to make our discussions simple, we shall now concentrate on a field with one spatial direction only. So we are considering the displacement field of a string in 1+1 dimension. So you have a string which vibrates like this. So this direction is phi of x comma t, and this is your, say, x direction. And this point is, say, x is equal to 0. And this point is x is equal to capital L. It's the length of the string. Okay? So we have, so let this field phi, for the time being, be a displacement field in the case of a vibration of string. Okay? And let us impose periodic boundary conditions, that is, for all times t, phi at x is equal to 0 is phi at x is equal to L. Take any one of the eigenfunctions, e to the power of I k dot x k. What is this thing, e to the power of I k dot x? It is k0 x0, ki xi. But this is equal to e to the power of k0. K0 is what? K0 down, K0 up is the same, because signature is mostly negative. This is time t. And this one will give us minus I k. If I take this up, this will give me a k vector. But here you have only one spatial direction. So this is nothing but the x component of k vector only. So this is kx times x. So this is what we shall have. And here also you can replace this omega k vector by kx, since it only depends on kx in 1+1 dimension. In 3 dimensions, it will be obviously omega k t minus I k vector dot x vector in 3+1 dimensions. So, since the displacement field satisfies these periodic boundary conditions, therefore, these functions that you have should also satisfy periodic boundary conditions. And if I just substitute this thing in this periodic boundary condition, then what we shall get is the time part will cancel from both sides, because this will not contribute to this condition. It will get cancelled. We will only have this term. It will give us e to the power of minus I kx into 0 is equal to e to the power of minus I kx into L. This is 1. But what does 1 mean? It is e to the power of pi n, where n is equal to 0, plus minus 1, plus minus 2, and so on. And therefore, you can compare from here, you can see that kx into L is to pi n. And therefore, kx is. So you see that the x component, you have only one component in 1 plus 1 dimension. The momentum actually gets quantized in this way. But I should just remind you that this momentum getting quantized in these discrete values, this has nothing to do with any quantum mechanics. There is no quantum theory here. No. This quantization arises due to the imposition of periodic boundary conditions. And you can see that quantization, this kind of quantization, this particular way in which the values that kx can take, this particular quantization of this kx values can also appear in a classical setup, in a classical theory. But it arises, it owes its origin due to this periodic boundary conditions. It has nothing to do with quantum mechanics so far. And you can see that if kx gets these discrete values, therefore the eigenfunctions, they also take discrete, they are also basically discretized. The eigenfunctions are also discretized because of these discrete values of this kx. But in the limit of this box of one dimension, box in one dimension, in the limit of this length L of the string going to infinity, this kx will again take a continuum of values. This discrete nature will go away and it will take a continuum of values. So kx again forms a continuum in the limit of L going to infinity. So once you have this, now what you can do is you can make a Fourier expansion of phi x, the field phi x, in terms of these plane waves. You can make a Fourier series expansion. And the expansion will be something like this. Sum over all the discrete kx values . So I'm not writing kx anymore, I'm writing just k. So now I have made a Fourier expansion of this field phi in terms of in this way, in terms of these plane waves, in terms of the plane wave solutions that we have obtained. And you should only remember that this k, this four momentum that you have, all the not all the components of this four momentum are independent. The k0 component, which is omega k, is related to the other three components in this way by the dispersion relation that you have in special theory of relativity. Yes.
Why we are writing AK and AK dagger? Sorry.
Good point. I was actually coming to that point. I wanted to tell you this. Here, you can replace it by a star. Since everything is classical here, therefore there is no question of taking a dagger, because these are not operators at this point, at this moment. If this is something that is a classical function, then the right hand side must also be a classical function. This e to the power of ik dot x, these are classical functions, no doubt. In this case, since this is a classical function, this ak and ek star, these are also classical functions. These are classical, these are not operators. Had this been an operator, then this ak and ak, then we have to use ak dagger. Now let me come to the classical case first. In the classical case, you must have a term like ak star into e to the power of ik dot x. Why? This follows from the reality condition of the scalar field. Phi star x should be equal to phi x. The only way you can satisfy this condition is to apply a complex conjugate term, is to add a complex conjugate term. This term is a complex conjugate of this term. Therefore, this term must be there so that phi x is a real function. Therefore, you have a complex conjugate here. When this field phi is not a classical field, when you discuss quantum fields in quantum field theory, once again, the standard prescription of quantum mechanics is that all the dynamical variables are represented by Hermitian operators, right? So when you do quantum mechanics in quantum field theory, the classical field gets replaced by a quantum field, and therefore it gets replaced by an operator. So this is an operator. So you can put a hat. We will not put a hat. When we discuss quantum field theory, we will take it for granted that when I write phi x, it is a field, quantum field. It is an operator, but actually there is a hat. So if this is an operator, then the right hand side must also be an operator, and the only way this can be a real operator is that this complex conjugate gets replaced by a Hermitian conjugate, a dagger. So AK and AK dagger are now operators when the left hand side is an operator. For a quantum field theory, the field gets replaced by an operator. You must have operators on the right hand side also, so that the left hand side is an operator. And for the reality, since this is a real scalar field, this should have a AK dagger instead of a complex conjugate. So in the classical case also, you can, for the simplicity of notation, instead of a complex conjugate, you can put a dagger. But only remember that if they are functions, then this dagger is basically equivalent to a complex conjugation, not a Hermitian conjugate. So this is the Fourier expansion. Of the field phi, of the real scalar field phi. Why do you have this factor? This factor you will understand in the next class. So today we shall stop here. This is a nice place to stop. This factor is a factor which is required for normalization purposes. And that is why we have put in a factor of square root 2 omega k l. And you will understand later why we have put such a factor over here. That you will understand in tomorrow's class. So if you have some questions at this point, you can ask, or else we can stop here for today. Is this okay? Is the discussion for today okay for you?
Yes, sir.
So what we shall do, what we have started with is, we shall first do canonical quantization of fields, of classical fields. We shall canonically quantize them, and as we move on in the course, we shall also try to quantize these fields using the path integral approach. So we shall do it in both ways.
Okay. Okay, sir.
Okay. So let us stop here for today. We shall meet tomorrow at 2 o'clock.
Okay.